Welcome back, my friends, to the darkest of times in Germany. We're planning our missions, and we're in a very dire situation. Our morale is even negative. I didn't know this would exist. We need to do something, anything, to be in a better mood. I mean, we have opened up a lot of opportunities, but what we really need to do, and thankfully, we have the marks for that at the moment, is go dancing. Otherwise the group will just dissolve. It will just dissolve. It's as bad as that. Here we go. Thankfully we get some marks from our supporters, and now let's go dancing. We travel to the east of Berlin and visit a nightclub that's still playing what the Nazis call Negro music, despite the ban of all un-German music. We'll dance all night like there's no tomorrow. A wonderful time. And we finally leave. The day is already dawning. This felt good. We need this back. We decide to go dancing and listen to good music. We have a lot of fun and laughing the whole night and feel recreated. An artist provides us with art pieces. Plus 30. The Wehrmacht victorious at Smolensk. After 3 weeks, the Wehrmacht wins the Battle of Smolensk. 310,000 Soviet soldiers are taken prisoner of war in Germany. That is, the scale is beyond compare, and every one of these is a man with probably a family, with... War is tears. War is tears. The result of war is tears. Tears everywhere. Tears and death. Bishop publicly attacks National Socialist leadership for mass killings. Münster Bishop Clemens August Graf von Galen denounces the mass killing of the mentally ill as ordered by the National Socialist leadership as murder. Well, he calls it as it is, and he was one of the nobles who resisted. They were, at this time, still a little bit protected, but later on that would also dissolve. The Reich Labour Service extended. The obligation to serve in the Reich Labour Service is extended from 6 to 12 months for young women and must be completed in the service of the Wehrmacht. 8th of August 1941. Maria Esser looks more and more tired and irritated lately. When we ask if everything is okay, she answers, "It's my boy. He's only 4 years old, but he already knows what air raid sirens sound like, and the worst thing is I can't change anything. I want him to have a happy childhood, enough food and plenty of friends, and instead I have to teach him what to do in a bombing." I can't change anything. These are hard times, but it's not true that you aren't doing anything. You are here, fighting for a better future for our son. I do my best, but when I think about what would happen to him if I'm killed or arrested, she sits silently for a while. "I'm afraid," she says. "You have my word, your child will never be alone." She looks at me and says, "Thank you. I just hope it will get better soon." Hopefully that was... Well, she's a little depressed. No wonder. Yeah, we took her in still while she was pregnant too. And now, what can we do? Oh, Karin Leopold can level up. It's all about the secrecy. It's all about the secrecy for me. And write more slogans on walls. Really, what do we have? We have 3 paint buckets. So we could do that. It's an option that is open to us. Could do something with the stacks of paper as well. Let's see what our contacts can do. The artist can provide us with art pieces. We have a piece of art now. And Fritz Hofer will introduce us to conservatives who are opposed to Hitler and his regime. Yeah, let's do that. Some more morale. You can collect donations. go into hiding. Yeah, that's what Wilhelm Etern, Kurt Wirth, and Gerhard Hagelstein should do in theory, but could meet a former unionist. How much time do we still have here? 13 turns. Writing slogans on walls. Is that something you two could do reasonably well? Piece of art. It will make everyone in the group happy. Okay. Ah, two women could do it. It can reach a lot of people, and it's okay. I mean, it's okay. Let's give them that. And we must do it like that. Play it safe. Supporters donating money, and we are trying to paint the walls. Come on. Night Count Leopold writes slogans on walls. Let's hide. Stay calm and move on. There's a dispute. Had to abort the mission. Terrible. The Etter has retreated to a safe place where nobody knows him. When he returns, he feels much safer than before. Bombing raids on Germany. British bomber formations attack Cologne and Berlin and cause severe destruction. In 1941 already, 15th of August, Great Britain and the Soviet Union sign a trade treaty. So that's really unlikely powers to be friends again with each other. Moscow, British and Soviet representatives sign a trade and credit agreement. The Soviet Union needs economic aid after the destructions caused by the Germans. Yeah, that burnt earth, like Napoleon did it. But worse, Furan. Because, yeah, technology alone makes it worse. Travel in low season. German holiday resorts are so crowded that the management of German tourism calls on the population to travel in the low season, if possible. 15th of August 1941. During our meeting tonight, Karin Leopold shares a story. I almost went to prison yesterday, and I wasn't even on a mission. What were you doing? Just talking, that's all. I was with a friend at a bar complaining that everyone's being drafted into the Wehrmacht. Maybe I was louder than I thought. Someone taps me on the shoulder and it was a policeman. What did he say? He was all red in the face as he barked at me. Behavior detrimental to the war effort is tantamount to treason. He threatened me to take me to prison. My friends and I tried to calm him down. I apologized and eventually he left me alone. Yeah, that was a close one. All of you remember, watch your mouths. These pigs only need the slightest reason to cut you off, so don't give them one. The drag, and we're already again down with a morale. That's absolutely crazy, but at least we're okay from the heat we're getting. We need a little bit more money, I guess, among the academics. A good teacher, Kurt Wirth, would be able to do this well. Wow, yeah, look at this. That's pretty good. A judge. How much would we get there? Oh, yeah, that's pretty good. But surely there's other ways to get some money. Collect donations in Kreuzberg. Yeah, that's something for Wilhelm Etter. That's really good. Let's have him do that. Meet a former unionist. Our friend the Social Democrat is pretty good at that. And here, collect donations in Spandau or meet a former unionist. Yeah, Kurt Wirth is going here. Meet a former unionist is something for Hagelstein, I guess. Yeah, and Leopold, Katrin Leopold will help Kurt Wirth. And then we can meet a former unionist here. Gerhard Hagelstein. Here we go. 14 marks. Codworth visits the known supporters among the academics. Oh my goodness. They're here. We have a witness. The witness leaves. And we're successful. People are outraged. They're willing to help us off. We get 20 marks. Now we're talking. Wilmetter visits the group's known supporters among workers in Kreuzberg. And he's successful. People give us a lot. 19 marks. In Reinickendorf, Maria Esser meets with a former unionist. See if he could be convinced to join the resistance. He and his friends join us. 4 supporters. At Hagelstein meets with former unionist in Köpenick to see if he could be convinced to join the resistance. Trade unionist is furious about the way the regime has limited the workers' rights, but Gerhard thinks he has been seen. The noise of the air raid sirens wakes me up. It's pitch black outside. I can hear hurried footsteps rushing down the stairs. Now it's getting real. Put something on. I put my coat and shoes and follow the white arrows along the staircase, pointing the way to the air raid shelter. Run as fast as we can. Klaus and Hermann, the 2 teenagers left in our building, are standing in front of the fire door. Finally, Herr Wert, it was high time. We were about to shut the door. Thanks for waiting for me. Hermann makes a grim face and writes my name on a list and opens the door. Boys, follow me in. Look around. There are a number of people from our building. I recognize Klaus's mother, Anne Manholt, and his sister, Elspeth, as well as Hildegard Pitz, Hermann's mother. In a corner are the Obsts, a friendly elderly couple that lives on the ground floor. Let's take a seat. Good evening, I say, and take a seat next to Anne. Hildegard, sitting opposite to us, waves to me. Klaus and Hermann close and lock the fire door. I'll hit it. We're in charge of this shelter, says Hermann. Anyone is missing, raise a hand. We look around. No one raises a hand. Good. Hermann nods and makes a note. Klaus stands next to him and makes a serious face. What's the situation? We're expecting a British bomber squadron, medium-sized, in the next half hour, says Hermann. Ach, nothing will happen, says Hildegard. Our air defense will take them down. They'll never reach Berlin. Well, Hildegard, they've reached Berlin before. Yes, but that was before they built the new anti-aircraft stations. And are you sure that will stop them? The Führer said so in his last speech, says Hildegard. From today forward, not a single enemy plane will reach Berlin. That's what he said. I see. You're so sure about that, why are you even in the shelter, comments Mrs. Obst from the corner. Are you questioning the Führer, asks Hildegard. We'll calm her down. This can only lead to trouble. I'm sure Mrs. Obst isn't just as fond of the Führer as anyone here, I say. Since when are you trained air raid helpers, I ask the boys. 2 years now, says Hermann. I've been in training since May, says Klaus. I mean, even if they are Nazis, it's something useful they're doing. Congratulate. Must make you proud, I say. A loud bang interrupts our conversation. The room shakes. The lights go off. We were hit, yells Klaus. We were not hit. It was close, but not our building, says Hermann. Look around. I try to look around. The lights off. It's pitch black in here. A child, Elspeth, is crying. A man whimpers. It's all right. It's all right. Everything is going to be fine. A woman's voice tries to comfort them. I move toward the crying child. I put my hands in front of me and move slowly through the room towards the voice. Is everyone all right? Is anyone injured? Asks Hermann. Can someone find a light? A match is lit. I see concerned faces. Then it gets brighter. Klaus holds up a Hindenburg light. We weren't hit, says Hermann, but it was very close, probably somewhere on our street. We'll look for Elspeth. Elspeth is frightened, but alright, so I turn to the Obsts. Mrs. Obst is holding her husband in her arms, his face buried in her chest, trembling and whimpering. He was the one whimpering. Can I help you, Mrs. Obst? I can't stand the dark, says Mrs. Obst. He will be fine in a bit, just give him time. I'm sorry. kind of man is this, says Hildegard, crying like a child? That kind of example does this set for our young people? Mrs. Obst holds her husband even tighter. Please calm down, Hildegard, we say. I mean, really, what is this? Look at those boys. She points at Hermann and Klaus. They're children. Yet, they know more courage than you, cowardly intellectuals. What can you expect, says Hildegard. Hildegard, please. Something flies through the room and hits Hildegard on the head. Ouch! What was that? Hildegard holds her hand to her head. On the ground next to her lies a tin can. Mrs. Obst is holding another can in her hand and says, one more word, you stupid cow, and you'll get this one too. But calm Mrs. Obst down. I try to interfere. Mrs. Obst shakes the can in her hand and says, let me talk, or you'll get one too. Oh, let's let her talk. My husband served in the last great war, you fool started. He brought this back from the front with him. What he left there was his soul, says Mrs. Obst. Well, listen to her. So don't you tell me anything about courage, Mrs. No plane can make it to Berlin. Oh, I swear to the Almighty you won't make it out of this shelter alive. Maybe we can stop Mrs. Obst. We'll offer her. I'm fine, says Mrs. Obst. Just tell her to keep her distance. The loud impact of another explosion shakes the bunker. This one was even closer, says Anne. Yes, but still not our building, says Klaus. Everyone all right? Someone knocks at the door. Hello, says a voice from the outside. Will you let us in, please? The bombers are incoming. Is that us? I think I know, says Klaus. Why don't you open the door? My guess, says Klaus, it's Mr. Gutmann. Your mother is right. Let him in, Klaus. Klaus walks to the door, but Hermann stops him. Hands off, I'll do it. Shoves the younger boy aside. Who is there? Hermann asks through the door. Would you open the door already? There might be another bomb drop here in any moment. Mrs. Louis Goodman and Paula and Elias, please let us in. It's really dangerous outside. The building down the road was hit and the fire is spreading. Let them in, says Anne. Don't you hear what they're saying? They are our neighbors, for God's sake. Yes, you still care for the people you knew. Maybe not for the numbers. Please open the door, boys. This is a family that needs shelter. No, I'm in charge for this bunker, says Hermann. It's my duty to stick to the rules, and the rules say the bunker is for Aryans only. Go away, he says the last words loud, making sure the Goodmans can hear him on the other side of the heavy metal door. We'll grab him and force him to open the door. I grab Hermann by the arm and pull him to the door. But he fights me off. Stop it, shouts Hildegard. My son is in charge here, and he's absolutely right. Jews are not allowed in the shelter. What you are doing is illegal. I will report you. Let these people in or you will regret it. Something flies through the air and hits the wall next to Hermann's chest. I turn around to Mrs. Obst, ready with another tin can. The next one will hit you in the head. I'm really good at this, she says. You hear what she said, Hermann. Now would someone please open that damn door, says Mrs. Obst. A tin can still aimed at Hermann. I could open it. No, Klaus, you go, says Anna. Son stutters. What, me? They're Jews. We're not supposed to. Really, I could open it. Anne grabs her son and yells, you open that door now. Klaus slowly opens the bunker door, his eyes downcast. I look at Hermann and Hildegard. Hermann has taken a seat next to his mother. Both stare at the family of three entering the shelter. Thank you, says Paula Goodman. We know we're not allowed here, but we're terribly scared. It looked like the fire would reach our building and Elias. He couldn't breathe because of the smoke. The son looks pale. How are you now, Elias? It's much better now, says Paula. Thank you for letting us in, says Louis Goodman. I'm sure the decision wasn't easy. He looks at Hermann and Hildegard staring at the wall, and I know that you're risking right now. I wouldn't have asked if it wasn't for Elias. We'll be fine. Oh, stop it, says Mrs. Obst. You are human beings, so are we. Well, some of us at least. So of course we let you in. spend the rest of the evening in silence. There are no further attacks, and soon enough, we hear the all-clear signal. The Goodmans are the first to leave the bunker, and will also leave the bunker. Hildegard stops me in the corridor and says, "What happened here tonight was an outrage. Normally, I'd turn you all in, all of you." She looks at Anne and Klaus, who are looking away. "Why should you do that?" "Because what you did was against the law," says Hildegard. "But since we're neighbors and we have known each other for such a long time, I'll look past it," she says. We nod. "This was the first and last time. If I see any of you helping a Jew again, I will turn you in. You know where I work. You know who I know. Don't try me. Come on now, Hermann," says Hildegard. I turn to Anne. "Do you think she's serious? I mean, she would reveal her son gave in, right? She means it. But she won't turn us in. It will make her own son look bad. After all, he was in charge of the bunker, and he was overthrown by an old woman." We laugh, even though there's nothing funny about this. Our morale is low again. Yeah, I'm used to that warning. Because of the events, Narva and Novgorod captured. The Wehrmacht conquers the two Soviet cities, Narva and Novgorod, on the Eastern Front. German companies can now recruit Spaniards. An agreement enables German companies to recruit Spanish workers for employment in the German Reich. Dutch cinemas forced to show movie. Goebbels' office orders all Dutch cinemas to show the anti-Semitic propaganda movie The Eternal Jew for the next 12 months. Yeah, there was a lot of propaganda against the Jews, mainly in print and everywhere on the streets with pictures and things like that. It was pretty terrible. But the movies, and that was Goebbels, who set on the new technology and the radio, were instrumental in spreading more and more propaganda and lies by the regime. 22nd of August 1941. During tonight's meeting, Wilhelm Etter complains that he can't sleep. "Sometimes I hear air raid sirens in my sleep, even when there are none. It's awful." Goering clearly failed in his promise to keep Berlin safe from bombings, eh? He sure as hell did. And you have to wonder how many other Germans feel the way we do. Is it possible for Hitler to lose popular support for this war if we feel the pain here at home? Yeah, that may indeed be true. I think you may be right, I say. But just imagine, what if the Red Army faction and the Allies decided it was worth it to firebomb civilians, like the Nazis did, which we learned a few episodes earlier. What will that mean for us? It means we're desperate, but we will not give up. We will never give up. We will resist, and you can also resist what you don't like and support what you like. Have a great time until next time, and happy gaming. This is Immanuel Kahn, signing out. See you soon, my friends.